Welcome to today's class of RF and millimeter wave IC design. So in today's class, we will look at the other two effects of nonlinearity, called as cross modulation and intermodulation. In the previous classes, we looked at various other nonlinear effects like harmonics, gain compression, and desensitization. So in that series, this is the fourth nonlinear effect what we are looking at this class. So this is cross modulation. So basically, cross modulation is defined again with our nonlinear system. So assuming there is a nonlinear system here available, the system is nonlinear, where the input is x of t, output is y of t, and there are input signals. We know that whole bunch of signals will be available at the input of any radio receiver. So considering that there is a signal at omega 1, and I'm assuming that a signal is weak, omega 1 is a signal, and considering that signal as a weak signal, so why I'm calling it as a weak signal is because there is another strong signal with a larger amplitude is available next to this signal. Now, I'm also considering one effect here where your signal omega 2 is large and also it is modulated. Almost I'm talking about a case where you have a signal, a weak signal, a weak signal which is a pure tone, and omega 2, a signal which is strong, which is very close by your weak signal. And we call this as strong because its amplitude is large. And this is an interferer because this is not the desired one. And also we are considering that this is a modulated signal. Right. So this is what we can see at the input of this nonlinear system. So the condition here is when a weak signal and a strong interferer, is applied to a nonlinear system. So what will happen at the output, or what are the expected components at the output is what we are interested here. So for that, let me take one example here. So I'll write what is y of t. So definitely y of t, I'll have the fundamental component alpha 1 into a1. Okay, let me write this as a1 cos omega 1t, which is the input signal number 1. And so this is at omega 1. Now at omega 2, since I have assumed the signal as a modulated signal, and for the time being, as a very simple case, if I'm considering the signal with some amplitude modulation, I will write the signal as A2 into, since its amplitude is modulated, 1 plus EM into cos omega MT. This is the simplest form what I can write, amplitude modulation, right? So considering omega 1 signal as a pure tone and omega 2 signal, which is amplitude modulated. So the amplitudes of both will appear in this fashion. Omega 1 is A1 and omega 2 is A2 into 1 plus M cos omega MT. Right. So if this is the case, if I write the output expression, I can write the output as y of t equal to alpha 1 plus, if I take the components, so it is 3 by 2 alpha 3 into a square, right? So A2 square. A2 square is basically A2 into 1. I'm just neglecting the other, since your omega 1 is a weak signal, A1 square term I'm just neglecting. That is why I'm just writing only the third component here, A2 into 1 plus EM cos omega MT. This is A2 with amplitude modulated. This is square. And the whole thing is the fundamental gain to the weak signal, which is A1 cos omega 1t. And I also want to mention that this is the desired signal here. This is desired, right? So can you guys just elaborate or expand this expression and tell me what will happen if an amplitude modulated signal is appearing at the input? So after expanding this, probably you may get an idea. So I can hold on for 1 minute. If you have answers, please respond in the chat box. Yeah, so for those who joined late, what we are doing is, again, looking at one nonlinear effect at the output of a third order nonlinear system, where at the input there are two signals. One is a pure tone at omega 1, which is weak, considered to be weak. And the second one is a strong interferer, which is amplitude modulated. I have just taken one example of modulation, and I'm assuming that it is amplitude modulated. In that case, the question is, how does this affect, or when a weak signal and a strong interferer, when it pass through a nonlinear system, what happens? So that can be understood only by elaborating this. I hope you guys are doing that. Did you see any effect over there? If you elaborate, if you expand this expression. Okay, let me do that. So this can be written as, this is equal to alpha 1 plus 3 by 2 alpha 3, this A2 square into, I'm just expanding only the inside term now, M square by 2 plus M square by 2 into cos 2 omega MT plus 2 M into cos omega MT. Right, this is what you can see, the entire thing should be multiplied by, again, A1 cos omega 1t. Right. I just expanded what is there inside, and the whole term should be multiplied with this. Yeah, very good, Vinod. Yeah, so the weak signal is getting modulated here, because you can see that the weak signal here is the omega 1 frequency. Now, the amplitude of that is A1 at the input, but now that amplitude is actually modulated by this modulating signal omega M, right? So, what we can say is, what happens here is, the transfer of modulation, from interferer to the signal. So whenever a weak signal and a strong interferer, which is modulated, is going to a nonlinear system, that modulation is getting transferred to the signal. And this effect is called as cross modulation. And the point to be noted here is, what we have analyzed here is only for amplitude modulation. And for the time being, we can only say that if the system is amplitude modulated, definitely that modulation is getting transferred. All right. So, so the weak signal's amplitude is getting modulated, or pictorially, what we can represent is, if this is the output, and this was the strong interferer at omega 2, and the weak signal is supposed to be at omega 1. But now that modulation is transferred a bit here. So this part is getting transferred here, and I can just express this weak signal as a modulated signal. So I forgot to mention that when we represent using, if it is a pure tone, we will use an impulse. Otherwise, we will actually use a wave of this kind. All right. So this is for amplitude modulation. Now, I will leave this as an exercise to you guys. You can try what happens if the other modulation schemes like phase modulation is coming into picture. So whether the phase modulation will get transferred to the weak signal or not. So you guys can analyze that. Definitely we will see that as one of the homework. All right. So this is the effect of cross modulation. And on continuing on this, we'll see the last effect of nonlinearity for our study now. So that is... just to summarize what I told here is, when a weak signal and a strong interferer, which is amplitude modulated, is appearing at the input of a nonlinear system. The weak signal will get the modulation get transferred from the strong interferer, and this is happening when there is amplitude modulation to the interferer. Now you can try out the other cases and how the modulation is getting transferred or not. You can analyze. That is what I'm leaving to you guys. Now coming to the last effect of nonlinearity. When I say last effect, this is what we will discuss in our course as one of the effect of nonlinearity. There are many other nonlinear effects as well. So that is called as intermodulation. This is something we need to understand in a little bit detail, because if you remember in our initial class, let me go back to the lecture. In our initial class, when we have looked at the components of a nonlinear system and when we have plotted for this frequency, if you remember, omega 1 and omega 2 were at 7 mega and 8 megahertz. But you can see that there are two components coming very close to the fundamental frequency, or the frequency of interest of this particular system. Those are appearing at 6 mega and 9 megahertz. And if you look at from where these components originated, you can see that those components are as a result of third order nonlinearity, and those products we called as intermodulation terms, right? And if you remember that day, we also mentioned that these components may cause some problem, because these components are appearing very close to the fundamental signal. The other components can be easily, when I use the term easily, it is again relative. The other components compared to this can be easily filtered out, but these components are not like that. So we need to understand it a little bit more about intermodulation, right? So far we were discussing about one desired signal and one more another strong interferer, but we know that the interferers coming along with this desired signal will be many, many, right? But for our analysis purpose, we have considered only one. Now, let us understand intermodulation by considering a nonlinear system. If you have questions in between, please post to the chat box. I'll answer to those questions. So this is again a nonlinear system with input and output x of t and y of t. And now I am considering there are two signals appearing at the input, one at omega 1 and another one at omega 2. Two signals appearing at the input of this system, one at omega 1 and another one at omega 2. All right, but what we will try to understand now is, I'll assume that these two interferers are accompanying a desired signal. What I meant to say is, previously we were considering only the desired signal and one interferer. But now we are extending that. If what happens if there are two interferers coming along with the desired signal? So for the time being, you can assume that you will have your desired signal somewhere here. Okay. But for analysis or the ease to analyze this in an easier way, I'm just not considering that now. But we'll definitely consider at the output. So if I have a signal here at the output, also we expect the same. Right. But if there are two signals at the nonlinear system, this can also bring a lot of other products, and we are interested in those products now, right? So a nonlinear system, at the input, we are considering two signals, one at omega 1 and omega 2. Now, when there are two signals of two different frequencies appearing at the input of a nonlinear system, as we have discussed before, and if we are characterizing third order nonlinearity to this block, when a sum of two signals coming at the input, x of t, there will be different terms inside. Mathematically, when we write, there can be x square t, there can be x cube t. And depending on the signal, you will get several products, right? So if you look at those products, what we understand is, let me write it here, when two signals of different frequency, that is what I have at the input, two signals of different frequencies. When they are applied to a nonlinear system, when they are applied to a nonlinear system, just using this short form NLS, we know that the output will exhibit several components, but we are specifically the output exhibit even frequency components other than harmonics. Frequency components, we know that harmonic components will be there from our initial discussion. Frequency components other than harmonics. So are you guys with me? Can I get some response in the chat box? All right, so the output exhibit frequency components even other than harmonics, and this is called as intermodulation. So the components which are appearing at the output other than harmonics are called as intermodulation terms, and we can expect such terms, intermodulation terms, and we can expect such terms at the output of a nonlinear system when or this arises. I'm just writing for you guys to understand. This arises from mixing of two signals, mixing of two signals when their sum is raised to a power greater than unity, greater than one. It's very simple. What I meant here is, in this case, your x of t is, let me write it as a1 cos omega 1t plus a2 cos omega 2t, or even you can assume that a1 equal to a2 equal to a. So your x of t is a cos omega t plus a cos omega 1t plus a cos omega 2t. Now that goes to this nonlinear system. The sum of this two terms of different frequency will be definitely raised to a power greater than unity. That is, x square t terms will be there, x cube t terms will be there, and these terms will definitely give you frequency components other than harmonics, and such products are called as intermodulation terms. Now we'll spend some time here to understand or to write different intermodulation terms. For that, let me just write first what is my input. Input can be written as a1 cos omega 1t plus a2 cos omega 2t. Still, you can assume a1 equal to a2 equal to a. Now, with that input, output y of t will be equal to, if I write the terms alpha naught plus alpha 1 x of t plus alpha 2 x square t plus alpha 3 x cube t is the output expression considering third order nonlinearity. And as we just mentioned, now x of t is a sum of two signals of two different frequencies, and their sum will be definitely raised to a power greater than unity here, that is x square t and x cube t terms. That will result in, or this results in mixing or multiplication terms. So let me list out the mixing or multiplication, or we otherwise we call them as intermodulation terms. So I'm not going to plug in the x of t here and expanding this expression again, because this exercise we have done in our initial classes. So I would like you guys to turn your pages back and see which are the frequency components coming. Now you can see that, the frequency components coming are omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, 2 omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, or 2 omega 2 plus or minus omega 1. These are the frequency components coming. I'm just writing those terms with their amplitudes again here. If I write, I can write it as, I'm just writing only the amplitude of those terms. So those terms are, alpha 2 a1 a2 and the 3 by 4 alpha 3 cubic terms. So alpha 2 a1 a2 cos omega 1 plus omega 2 into t. I don't know whether you guys are feeling I'm going a little fast. Why I'm doing that is because this analysis we have already done. That's why I'm just taking the results from there. Alpha 2 a1 a2 cos omega 1 minus omega 2 into t. This is the components at omega 1 plus or minus omega 2. Similarly, if I list out the terms at omega 2 omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, I'll have 3 by 4 alpha 3 a1 square a2 cos 2 omega 1 plus omega 2 into t plus again the same term 3 by 4 alpha 3 a1 square a2 cos the difference term is 2 omega 1 minus omega 2 into t, right? And the last product will be 2 omega 2 plus or minus omega 1. And if I write that, it is 3 by 4 alpha 3. Instead of a1 square, it will be a2 square a1. In this case, both are same. Cos of 2 omega 2 plus omega 1 into t plus 3 by 4 alpha 3 a2 square a1 cos 2 omega 2 minus omega 1 into t. So what I have done is I have just taken the terms directly from here with the corresponding amplitudes, but just I wrote the complete signal by writing the cosine expressions as well. Right, now if you look at these terms over here, you can see that as I mentioned, there are two different frequencies. Their sum is raised to a power greater than unity, and that is resulting in frequency components other than harmonics, and such components or such frequency components are called as multiplication, mixing or intermodulation terms. Now, in general, what I can do is I can write it as P omega 1 plus or minus Q omega 2. So intermodulation terms will be of the order P omega 1 plus or minus Q omega 2, where if this is this, if the form of intermodulation product is of this form, I can talk about the order of intermodulation, because you would have observed I was telling this as second order intermodulation term, this as third order intermodulation term. Now, how will we say the order of such terms is, if the frequency component is of the form P omega 1 plus or minus Q omega 2, we will write this P plus Q as the intermodulation order. Intermodulation order, where P and Q both are, both should be greater than zero. So intermodulation order, the P plus Q is the intermodulation order. In that case, we can see that P equal to 1 here and Q equal to 1 here, right? Because both the coefficients of omega 1 and omega 2 are 1. When both P and Q are 1, P plus Q will be the intermodulation order, and P plus Q is 2 here. So I will say this is IM2, second order intermodulation term. Similarly, in this case, P equal to 2 and Q equal to 1. So this is intermodulation of the order 3. And this one also intermodulation of the order 3. All right. So again, coming back to the discussion, what we have done is a nonlinear system with two signal frequencies at omega 1 and omega 2. And we have seen that there will be a lot of products coming in. Now, how is this relevant to our study now? So for that, I'm just again bringing back our nonlinear system here. Nonlinear system. And at the input, I have frequencies at omega 1 and omega 2. Omega 1, omega 2. We have a1 equals a2 equals a. That is there. Now I am just looking at another desired signal very close to this, and I'll assume that now two interferers are accompanying your desired signal, and that is going to a nonlinear system. Now from the study or from the discussion what we have made just now, if I write the frequency components at the output, I can definitely write there will be omega 1, there will be omega 2, and I'm just leaving this term over here, which is of omega naught, and I'm marking all the other products now with another color. So if omega 1 and omega 2 are going in, I'm not looking at the harmonics now, but I'm just looking at the intermodulation terms. So okay, let me take one example. I'll ask you guys to plot this. Consider omega 1 is 2.4 giga and omega 2 is 2.44 giga. Now, I would request you guys to write what is omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, 2 omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, and 2 omega 2 plus or minus omega 1. Write all the frequencies here and plot the corresponding products, and let us see how it is affecting your desired signal. Are you guys with me? Can I get some response in the chat box? All right, so can you guys try? And write down the different frequencies coming in here. Okay, so you can post in the chat box. Let me know which are the frequencies at omega 1 plus or minus omega 2. Omega 1 plus or minus omega 2. 0.36. I didn't get that. How come it is? Two point four is omega 1 and 2.44 is omega 2. Okay, I'm asking omega 1 plus or minus omega 2 terms, not the third order intermodulation. Yes, it is 4.84 giga and 400 mega, right? Yeah, 400 mega. So if I plot those terms, 4.84 giga, so this is 2.4, this is 2.44, so definitely 4.84 should be somewhere higher, somewhere here. And we know that the amplitude will be a little smaller by looking at the amplitudes there. I'll just write this as 4.84. This is 4.84 giga. And on the same time, you will get one more term on the left side, which is 400 mega. So I'll mark it as 400 mega. Right. Oh, yeah, it should be 40 mega, right? It is 0.04. Yes, very good. It is 40 mega. Yeah, so that is quite on the lower side. So I'll just write this as intermodulation 2. This is IM2 and this is also IM2. Similarly, if you go for omega 2 omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, I'll get a few other terms. It is 7.24 giga and 2.36 giga. Very good. So 2.36 giga. So 2.4 is here. So 2.36 should be somewhere very close. So I'm marking that 2.36 exactly on the left side. And I'm marking, and I'm just writing this frequency as 2.36 giga. Similarly, one more you will get on the other side. Yeah, the amplitude is definitely a little smaller. That is it. No, that should be a little away, 7.24. So I'll mark somewhere here, 7.24 giga. And these are IM3 products, IM3. Now, if I look for the last one, you will get 7.28 giga and 2.48 giga. So 7.28 giga will be still farther, somewhere here. And 2.48 should be somewhere here. 2.48 giga. All right. So what we have done here is, we assume that there are two interferers accompanying a desired signal. And by considering the nonlinearity effect only on the interferer, we have written all the products. And you can see that the products of different color, blue and red. So red colors are intermodulation terms of the order 2. And you can clearly see that if your desired signal is coming close to this omega 1 and omega 2, and say I'm considering that your omega naught is exactly, it is 2.36 gigahertz or within that range, you can see that the IM2 products are still okay. IM2 products, because one is coming in 40 mega and another one is coming at 4.84 giga. It is not directly interfering with the desired signal. But you can see that IM3 terms, there are different IM3 terms coming in. There are four IM3 terms. In that, two terms, one appearing at 2.36 and another one appearing at 2.48, which are very close to the desired signal. And there are chances that you can see that here, if my desired signal is here, your desired signal will be corrupted. Your desired signal will be corrupted. So why I said it will be corrupted, because this intermodulation term of order 3 is falling exactly on the band of interest, or exactly on the weak signal, the signal what we are considering along with the interferer. All right. So now you may appreciate, because initially probably you would have understood that even here I was telling these terms are falling very close to the fundamental frequency, but in reality what happens is these terms, multiple frequencies are appearing at the input, and when they produce intermodulation term, they may fall on the desired signal, and this will create problem, or this will corrupt your desired signal. To give little more clarity, why I have taken some input of this type is because, as I mentioned even in one of the previous class, at the input of any receiver, we don't have the facility to accept a single frequency signal. We do accept, or we do receive band, and later we will select the channel within this band on a later stage. Now this again depends on the type of architecture what we use, and in general for heterodyne architectures this is what we do. So I hope you understand the difference between band and channel. Now, band is actually the entire frequency of a particular wireless standard what they prefer, and channels are the signal frequencies within that band. So at the input of any receiver, we generally prefer to accept a larger bandwidth, to have a better realization of better filters at the input. There are so many things connected, we will see those things later. Now, only one thing what I want to point out here is, now this intermodulation terms will definitely create some problem, really problem causing components. And if such problem causing components are there, when we do study RF IC design, we should know how these intermodulation products can be characterized, or we should definitely have a performance metric to say that, okay, this much of intermodulation components are okay, or this much of intermodulation components are not okay. Like, so to say that, you should have a performance metric. So to characterize, IM3 products, we do have a performance metric, and we call it as third intercept point. Third intercept point called as IP3. Generally, we define this third intercept point at the input. In that case, we call it as IIP3. If I refer at the output side, we call it as OIP3. But all these things we will see in the next class. So this we call it as input IP3, and this we call it as output IP3. So like what we did with a compression point, 1 dB compression point, this is another performance metric which will tell us about the nonlinear effect of an intermodulation term, and that we call it as third intercept point. We see how do we calculate this intercept point and what are the other significance of intercept point on our later class. All right. So with this, I'm winding up today's class. If you have questions, you can definitely ask now.